This episode of the Party Loaded Podcast is proudly sponsored by Audible.com. Check out their awesome catalogue of audiobooks with over 180,000 titles to choose from. And be sure to grab a free audiobook on us and support the show by visiting audibletrial.com/endgame.
Let's party.
Welcome back to Party Loaded. It is Wednesday, the 15th of March, solid right into the middle of one of the most wonderful months we've had in a long, long time. My name is Luke Ritalik. We are here to talk about video games tonight, as we always are, one of those things. We're doing video game chat.
Oh,
that's how it's working.
Fucking words.
I know. It's my brain is fried after a long week of it. So we have a few people here joining me to do that. We have Ollie. Welcome back.
Hello.
Thanks for coming. Not that you wouldn't have. Jam, of course, is here as well. Welcome, Jam.
Hi.
Hello. Mimo is out tonight, but we have a sub in. We swapped the Mimo for a Millpool. So we actually have a newcomer to the show tonight, a good friend of ours, Christian Polson-Brown. Welcome, Christian.
Yo, thanks for having me on. It's awesome to be here with you tonight, guys.
Awesome.
Welcome.
Nice.
Yay.
Temp Mimo. You're Temp Mimo now.
Temp Mimo? Yeah.
Actually, Temp Mimo.
No, there's got to be a better... Temp Jam works because it rolls off the tongue. Temp Mimo's a
okay,
bit
okay, fine. Bit temp much. Jam, I'll be Mimo.
No, you don't get to choose another role.
Ain't no one's Temp.
He's
right?
A sub-Mimo.
No, Christian's his own man. He can carry this all on his own, so that's cool.
That's right.
Yeah. I think we should probably do like a proper introduction because we've all known each other for a number of years, of course, but the rest of the listening public will not. So do you want to just give everybody a real quick rundown as to who the heck you are and what you know about the video games? What's going on?
Sure, yeah. Well, I mean, I've been, as all of you guys, a lifelong gamer. So grew up with the NES starting in my Amiga 500 and gaming ever since. Fairly had the Nintendos and the Segas as a kid and played PC games, so done it all. And then as far as meeting you guys and Luke in particular, met him through the Games Workshop hobby. Mm. He's actually my manager for a while at one of the stores.
What was that like?
Yeah. That was...
Sounds like a nightmare.
No, Luke was a good manager. Yeah, it was good. He was always very
Luke is
motivated
the power of the editing,
and passionate about the hobby and stuff. So, it was good.
That could have gone anywhere. I'm real glad how that went.
He wants to be invited back.
Well, I'm very
back.
Conscious of the fact that I'm a guest on your podcast, Luke, so, you know.
Yeah, but you'd get the invite back from the other three if you burned your bridge with me tonight, so it's not really
yeah.
too much.
Yeah.
Luke is out. We need a new Luke.
That's awesome.
But, I mean... Yeah, not much more to say than that. Nowadays, I've been studying for a long time. I've got a biology degree. I'm finishing my master's at the moment. And not much more. That's me.
Nice. So obviously knowing Christian for quite a while as we have, one of the things we know is that he's a mad keen video gamer who knows a lot of stuff. So pretty good fit with the team tonight to discuss some things of... fairly important nature, I would venture. I think there's some pretty big things going on at the moment that we're keen to get your perspective
I'd say if I fill a niche, it'd be anything to do with Japanese games. Mm-hmm. I've noticed with you guys, nobody really seems to be hitting the Japanese games too much. No real weebs on the show. But I'll be the resident weeb for tonight.
Nice. We could do with more weebs. That's good. Yeah. I think you're probably right. The closest we've come in recent history is probably chatting a little bit of Final Fantasy, but that's pretty mainstream as far as a lot of that the Japan anime culture and gaming goes. So
yeah.
Agreed.
You guys probably aren't as hyped for Persona 5 as I am.
Look, I must admit, I am actually tempted by that. With absolutely no experience going in, on hype alone, I've actually sort of taken a bit of an interest. So we'll see. You may talk me into that
it's
one.
It's going to be so good.
Yeah. It'll be good. cool. We have tons to talk about tonight, and we've got quite a bit of opportunity with Christian on to actually dig into a bit of Switch talk, which will be a bit of fun. So, unfortunately, nobody can be told what the Switch is. You have to see it for yourself. So, Christian, This is your last chance. After this, there's no turning back.
Yep.
You take the blue Joy-Con, the story ends, you wake up in your bed and you believe whatever you want to. You take the red Joy-Con, you stay in Mario Land and we'll see how deep the pipeline goes. So make your choice.
Oh, God. I had the gray Joy-Con, yes? So I'll abstain from that.
Oh, that's a shame.
Good answer.
Yeah, nice. Now, a little bit of Matrix humor there. Did you guys actually hear the Matrix is going to be rebooted today? That was just ridiculous news.
Yeah.
Possible.
Yeah.
I like the idea that they literally just reboot the Matrix. They just turn it off and turn it back on again.
Yeah, 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 that works.
Just the IT crowd in the background.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. All right, well, anyway, so seriously, Switch, you are the one out of all of us that's actually picked up the hardware and been playing with it for the last, 2 weeks now? It's been out 2 weeks? It has been 2 weeks.
Yeah, close on 2 weeks.
Holy crap, that's actually flown by. So, yeah, I mean, do you want to give us a bit of a rundown what your experience with it's been so far and, what was your motivation to sort of get the day one console purchase and what you actually picked up with it and stuff? So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I am always a sucker for the new and shiny. So the day one purchase was a no-brainer for me. I got my PS4 on launch day. I get most consoles on launch day. And I am a bit of a Nintendo fanboy too, so I was definitely going to pick one up. I've been a diehard supporter of the Wii U despite its lackluster library. So yeah, I pre-ordered it as soon as it was announced basically and was keen to get it. And I've been pretty impressed by it. It's definitely got some sort of middle of the road features, but overall I'm really happy with it. I think the build quality is the first thing I noticed, that it feels like a premium piece of hardware as opposed to the Wii U's gamepad, which always felt a bit like a Fisher-Price toy or whatever.
Yeah.
With the shiny shiny hollow feel kind of thing.
The shininess and like the hollow feel a bit. Like it just felt a bit airy, whereas the Joy-Cons on the Switch, they feel really solid and they've got a nice weight to them, almost like they could be made out of metal, which they're not, but they have a nice sort of robust build to them.
Mm-hmm.
And the screen too is a much nicer screen than the color-drained Wii U gamepad screen that was pretty poor. I'd say the screen, it doesn't quite match up to the Vita's nice color palette on the OLED, on the original Vita model, but it's still really, really nice to look at, very clear and smooth, so that's pretty nice. I haven't had any of the hardware issues that some other people have had. I haven't had any sync issues with my left Joy-Con or anything like that, so I've been fortunate there. So yeah, overall, I'm pretty happy with it.
Nice. Yeah, I saw this last week that apparently Nintendo released a list of things that you can try if you're having those sync issues with your left Joy-Con. And some of the things mentioned on that troubleshooting list were things like don't have your Switch next to any metal objects, don't have it next to a fish tank, don't have the cords next to bundles of cords. There was some weird stuff on there, like, don't have your Switch next to any metal objects, like a TV, for instance. It was weird.
Close friend of mine had the left Joy-Con issue, and he tried all of that, including the aquarium thing, because he actually had an aquarium between his Switch and his couch, and he tried it all, and nothing helped at all. And then he actually got a replacement for the hardware, and that fixed it straight away. So it just went to show that it wasn't to do with the network environment. It was literally that Joy-Con was faulty, and because the replacement worked straight away. So
that's super weird.
Some of the actual pieces of hardware are faulty.
The fish tank thing's a weird one. Like, I would have assumed that the reason for that could be something behind maybe like pump motors having magnetic components in them or something like that, interfering with the signal. But I mean, there's also been mention of the Switch in some cases performing poorly in houses where there's a lot of conflicting Wi-Fi signals, which a lot of devices these days, any other console and TVs even use a lot of Wi-Fi tech these days too, so there's a fair hotbed of points of failure there. A lot of things you need to go through, which is a bit of a shame, but it's good to hear that you're not having any trouble with yours. That's good. Have you actually had it out and about?
Yeah, well, I had one sort of Nintendo advert quality experience, I think of it as, like, the sort of thing that Nintendo would love to put in their ads, where I did some laundry and I don't have a dryer and it was raining outside, so I went to the laundrette to dry my clothes and took my Switch along with me and propped it up on the table, and while my clothes were drying, continued to play Zelda. Nice. So that was like a perfect little scenario that to demonstrate the portability. And that was a nice little proof of concept.
So when you actually open up the box, do you get the invite to the Millennial Roof Party there, or do they post it separately? How does that work?
The what?
The Millennial Roof Party.
Oh, right. Yeah. With what was her name? I remember the girl from that ad. They people mocked up like an amiibo of her and stuff. Like Susan, I think her name might have been.
But, oh, yeah, really?
That was awesome.
I had no idea.
Like, people made her into like a bit of a meme.
Yeah. Actually, that doesn't surprise me. I would, you know, the thing about Nintendo, and they've shied away from doing this kind of stuff. This is where I think they could probably just turn around and own that. Like, it's a great example being, you know, Blizzard's Jeff Kaplan has recently become a meme in his own right with a lot of the videos he's done sort of being edited by people online and clipped together into these monstrosities of humor. Nintendo need to just take the same approach. Like, when they have characters like that are just ripped on, just own it, you know, just take it and make it their own thing.
Totally, yeah.
Yeah, that'd be good.
They've tried a little bit, like they've taken on board some of the jokes around like Reggie and Bill Trinan from like Nintendo of America.
True.
Like the My Body Is Ready stuff from E3 a while ago. They play around with it a little bit, but I think they could embrace it a bit more.
Yeah, that'd be cool. Nice. So just the Zelda on the Switch then? None of the other launch titles really sort of got your attention? Not planning on picking up any Master Blaster when that hits or anything like that?
No, so the only other games I've played, I downloaded the Snipper Clips demo, but that's really a multiplayer experience. You can play it single player, but from what I hear, the true joy of that game is the hilarity that ensues when you are trying to coordinate with another person.
Mm-hmm.
So playing solo and switching between the little characters didn't really work so well. And the other game I played is a game called Vos, which is a pretty obscure game. It's like a rhythm game. Again, weeb. So I like my Hatsune Miku like rhythm style games. So this is like a sort of, you know, Guitar Hero with your fingers, J-pop sort of game. It's a port from a mobile, like an iOS game,
okay. But
it works really well on Switch, and it's actually the only Switch launch title that you can't play on the TV. It's handheld mode only.
Interesting. Yeah, I've heard mention of a couple of games like that, and a couple of games that have actually come out without the Pro Controller support as well, which sounds like another weird one. Did you end up investing in the Pro Controller, or is that something you'll do down the track?
I wanted to wait to see how the Joy-Con grip felt, and I am perfectly happy with the Joy-Con grip. Like, using it, I actually forget that I'm holding like a three-piece transformer of a controller, and it just feels like one controller in my hand, so I'm perfectly happy with the Joy-Con grip. I've had heard some people say, you know, people with really big hands, it can feel a little small, but you know, I haven't had any sort of issue with that. I think the Joy-Con grip works fine. The offset sticks are a little strange, how the right stick is quite low on the pad and the left stick is quite high, so it's kind of like the Xbox 360 controller, but a little more offset than that. But I got used to it pretty quick, so no drama.
Okay.
I dread having to use the separate Joy-Cons, how they've said that, you know, you can play with just holding one tiny little Joy-Con when you're playing like two-player.
Yeah.
That seems like it'd be a nightmare because those things are so tiny.
Yeah. I'm curious whether there's any sort of third-party alternate models released for that kind of activity that, you know, may or may not actually clip back onto the Switch, but have a bit more surface area when it comes to how much you can actually hold in your hand. I'm sure someone's going to think of that, and there'll be a market for it for sure.
Totally.
Yeah.
I'd love to see that. I would love to see, like, if they, as they inevitably probably will, release the Smash Bros. Wii U, if they port that to Switch, if they did, like, GameCube Joy-Cons, where you snap them onto either side and it's like you're holding left and right side of a GameCube controller, because that's always the preferred way of playing Smash Bros.
Okay, nice. Yeah, that'd be cool. Nice. All right, well, we won't talk too much Zelda at the top of the show because we've got a whole topic dedicated to that a little further in. But yeah, other gaming this week, Ollie and Jam. Jam, how's your Horizoning going? You plugging along in that game?
Yes.
Mm?
I'm loving it. Yes. I checked last night, I'm about, according to the stats page, 46% in.
Okay.
So I'm pretty sure I'm a little over halfway through the actual main storyline, because I've been getting sidetracked with a lot of side quests and bits and pieces, but I'm fairly sure I've only got two or three robots that haven't been revealed to me in my little notebook encyclopedia thingy. It's I'm loving it just as much as I was loving it last week, and I want to be playing it right now. I don't want to be talking to you.
And then
basically, it's great. Yeah. The characters are still really intriguing, and I want to get to know more. I'm still very curious about the main plot and also fascinated with the environment. Just the number of photos keeps ticking up.
Yeah, actually, you shared some pretty impressive really ones does. During the week. There was some good stage shots there. I was loving it. Yeah.
You've seen the tiniest fraction. I hacked a rather large robot the other day to fight another rather large robot with overdrive, and I sat in the tall grass right next to them while they faced off and just kept pausing every few seconds looking for like a new photo op because it looked so spectacular. It was just gorgeous. So I need to upload them all. It's just so much fun.
No, it is a very
I'm doing
game.
Good.
Nice. So are you finding that the side quests and stuff are a huge distraction, or is it more just that you've fallen down the rabbit hole and you really want to get back to the main story?
No, I actually, since last week, I actually focused on the main story a little bit, pushed through because I wanted to uncover more of the map.
Yeah.
And because certain people in our friend group are very unsubtle with their supposedly vague... talking
Luke's being
about the game.
Very modest and boasting about his achievements in game.
So I wanted to, you know, get to a few places and moments before they were spoiled for me. But now I found that I'm not sure that the leveling for the main questline has been done correctly because it doesn't feel right. Apparently I'm more than double of what I need to be to complete the quests that I'm at and they're not easy. So I'm happy now where I'm at, just stepping away for a little bit, trying to go back, you know, get some of the things I've missed. I know I've missed cauldrons and ruins, and I've got this long list of errands and side quests. So I'm just going to run around, see what I find, do bits and pieces, and then when I feel like it, I'm sure I'll return pretty quickly.
Yeah. I found in terms of the difficulty level for a lot of the main quests in that game, there was a point where things just clicked for me, and it wasn't relating to sort of leveling or uncovering different skills or something like that. There was a moment where I kind of just sunk a bit more time into learning each of the creature's patterns and weaknesses, and the penny sort of just dropped, and I knew how to strategize each of the combats differently. And I mean, Ollie, you and I have talked about particularly using the rope caster a bit more on some of the flying creatures.
Oh, so much. It's just fun.
I love the rope caster.
Exactly. Like, I mean, the philosophy that sort of seemed to be the case a lot earlier was that, you know, people have a lot of different ways of approaching these creature combats, and there seems to be a lot of different ways of skinning the cat. But the more that I played, the more I tended to draw the conclusion that I think there definitely is a one or two best approaches for each of the different creature types. I mean, I'm not saying that you couldn't take them down with other styles, but
you can. My brother hardly used the rope caster. Didn't like it.
Yeah.
Didn't enjoy it. Mm. Has his own methods and tactics and preferences. Prefers the overt, all out, come at me. I'm the one who's sneaking around trying to set things up to best advantage. So it's just, it's pretty amazing the multitude of ways you can fight these things.
Yeah. No, the thing that really sort of got me practicing some of the different techniques was the hunter's trials that you get to do. So you to sort of – you basically got a timed approach to different challenges involving taking down creatures or interacting with them in different ways. And the fact that to get the best score on a lot of those, you need to actually achieve your goal in under usually 2 minutes, it really puts the pressure on and makes you sort of figure out the most absolutely efficient, optimized way of doing it. So that is good training for the rest of the game, I found out, and I probably left a lot of that training a bit too late, as it turned out. But no, it was good. Yeah, I've finished with Horizon now, so I've wrapped up the story. Super satisfied with the entire game, and I think probably the best measure of where I was at when I finished the game completely was that I had 100%ed it. I got the platinum trophy, and even after doing all that, I actually wanted to keep playing. So after actually completing every possible thing I could have done in the game, I wanted to keep playing it.
So you got the platinum trophy without having to sort of specifically hunt down any trophies. They all sort of happened organically, did they?
Well,
or did you actually?
I had chosen to 100% the game sort of based on the achievement screen that you get in the UI. So it does give you a pretty good indication as to what you actually need to complete to get 100% measured in-game. And my assumption was that that would translate mostly to what you required to get the Platinum sort of outside of the game, because that sort of tracked on your PS4 console more than anything. And as it turned out, when I got the 100% sort of ticked over in-game, completed the main quest, completed all the side quests, got all the items that I needed, all that sort of stuff, I checked my progress towards Platinum, and there was only one achievement that I hadn't gotten, and it was something like get 3 death from above kills, which is one of the skills. I just had to go back in and take out a couple of small watches by jumping down onto them from like on top of a boulder, basically. And then I got the Platinum. So I was pretty much there already, which is good. But yeah, like
I like that when you don't have to like go back and play the game again on the harder difficulty to get the Platinum trophy, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
It's nice that you can get it in one playthrough.
Yeah, exactly. And it was actually the first game I've ever platinumed. So that was a little bit of a personal achievement for me. I was quite happy with that. It was good. And now I've got the bug and I'll probably want to do it again. So we'll see how that goes.
Move on to Dark Souls now, Luke.
Oh, God, Well, yeah, actually, Mass Effect will probably be the next one, actually, to be fair.
Mass Effect is one of those ones where you'll probably have to play it more than once, though, because you need to do, like, the Paragon and Renegade and stuff.
It's going
to
be worth it.
Yeah. Well, actually, I'm not so sore about that, because with Mass Effect, playing it more than once does potentially mean a completely different experience depending on some of the things you do. Like, I'll definitely do two playthroughs anyway, because I'll do one as the Scott character and one as, what's the female's name in Andromeda? Is it Scott and Sarah? Ryder?
I don't know. I'm not invested in them yet. Sure. Because they're not Shepard. I haven't bothered learning their name.
Hashtag not Shepard.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's Scott and Sarah. So I'll definitely do a playthrough with both of them and try and make each of them as different as possible with all the dialogue choices and stuff, so get those experiences. But yeah, no, it'll be good. It'll be good fun. And now that Horizon is knocked out of the way, focusing full on Zelda, just in time to be ready for Mass Effect coming in the next week and a bit. So that will be good. Yeah. Ollie, what's going on your end? What have you been playing?
I've been playing a little bit of this and that. I did a bit more Black Wake with Jam. That was good fun.
Yay!
She got to hear the amazing pirate voices and the ridiculous British voices.
It's brilliant. The Navy is freaking fantastic.
Did you do your super ochre pirate thing you wanted to do?
I haven't, no. I didn't get on the comms at all. I was just using the...
Jam, you would be the best at it, like, out of all of us.
Well, yeah, when we're playing with friends, I'll go nuts.
Yeah, okay.
But we had some sour grapes trying to captain or have a mutiny with the captain on some of our ships, so I was just like, I'm not getting on chat. I was just using the preset, the voice commands. They're so over the top and ridiculous, especially for the females. It's so just haughty-taughty. Ew!
Oh, really?
Marvelous! Oh, the cannon's empty! And you're running around sipping tea to heal. It's just so ridiculous. I had so much fun.
Nice. Blackwake, I will pick that up. For me, it's just a question of split focus at the moment. There's just too many big games requiring attention, so it'll hit that one up at the end of the month. Have they actually got a schedule?
Is that Steam, is it, Blackwake?
Yeah, it's only
Steam. Early access at the moment.
Mm.
Still a bit janky, but like the melee combat's awful.
Mm.
I can't get it to work.
I killed 7 people with a cutlass because I boarded the enemy ship.
That was
glorious.
But the actual captaining of the ship, it makes such a massive difference if you have a competent captain. Like, incredible difference. And you just follow his orders. Doesn't matter what's going on around you, you follow his orders and you can recover from anything and take out the enemy. It's so good.
Pretty cool.
We'll have to see how it stacks up next to Sea of Thieves when that drops this year, which can't be too far away. I think that's actually mid-year, actually.
Pirates making a comeback.
Yeah, in big way. Well, we've got a Pirates of the Caribbean film out later this year as well. There's something else pirate-related that I'm totally fubbing on that's coming out at some point. I don't know. It'll come to me later.
Maybe he's having flashbacks to playing Pirate Warrior in Hearthstone.
Yeah, actually, that's true. That could very well be it, actually.
Don't say the H word.
Have they actually got a schedule for the Black Wake development?
Censorship. Like,
have they got that listed as like planned for full release at a point this year, or is that open-ended?
Not that I know of. I think it's just as they go sort of deal.
Yeah. So could be as long as a piece of string sort of thing. Yeah.
I'm pretty sure they have a blog talking about upcoming bits and pieces, but I just jumped in for the lols.
Yeah, yeah.
yeah.
Rather funny.
I don't mind that sort of thing, because we can play it sort of during early access and then, you know, come right back around on it when it has the full release and sort of sees a new lease on life. So, yeah.
And there's enough of a mechanic there for it to be enjoyable now with the promise of all those other wonderful bits and pieces they could add. But I can't climb rigging for shit. I cannot figure out how to get up there without falling off the side of the boat. Like, what is the magic trick?
She can't figure out how to do the movement keys. You just move up it.
But I don't move up it. I'm not even joking. I just slide off the side. Like, oh. Anyway, I just dibs not going up to the crow's nest.
Yep.
Yeah, that's fair.
What about making a trip to somewhere else instead, Jam? You want to go to PAX? How about we go to PAX?
I do.
So gaming news of the week. Jam, you can kick this one off.
PAX tickets. PAX tickets are on sale for PAX Oz 2017 in Melbourne.
Mm-hmm.
I had the dates here. Where did they go? October 27th to 29th. They went on sale at noon yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
At the moment, you can get the early bird special for all 3 days at $160. And clever things. They threw in some loot that you can pick up with your registration too, which I know most of us have paid.
My wallet.
Thank God. There's a $50 mystery bag of swag and a little $25 set of dice. So
now, I must admit, I looked at the dice and I thought I should probably be good and not, you know, spend the extra on those. And then I noticed that they were machine cut, like metal dice, and I was just like, ah, shit.
Yeah.
And because we're all D&D nerds, you know you had to do it, because otherwise you'd be the only one at the table without them and you'd feel it's left true. Out.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
So wait a minute, this is pre-order bonuses for PAX tickets?
Yeah, essentially. Well,
essentially?
Yeah.
Ticket DLC?
Yeah.
Is there a season pass?
Well, there is a special offer. If you order, I think it's by the 28th, you go in the draw to potentially win a free Switch and copy of Zelda.
Yep.
So that was another nice little incentive too.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, already looking at accommodation.
Mm-hmm. I have made the decision.
Did not take long.
I was going to say, I have made the decision one way or another that I will be taking a Switch to PAX this year. So if I don't win it, I'm going to be buying one, because that's going to be a good test opportunity, I think, for the whole thing. And honestly, given how big...
No Street Pass, though. No Street Pass.
I know.
That's so sad.
I know.
It was awesome at PAX with the 3DS Street Pass. It was so good.
Yeah. Yeah, that was good. You actually introduced me to that like a number of years ago, and that was stupid fun. That was really, really good.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, given how many 3DSs you see around the place, you know, at the gaming lounges and on the beanbag areas and that sort of stuff, I have a suspicion that a good third of that at least will be replaced by Switches this year. I think it'll be a pretty big thing, so it will be good.
So the lack of the clamshell design on the Switch makes it a little, like, less easy to carry around, because you can't protect the screen as easy. You need like a carry case.
Yeah,
but I don't think it'll deter too many people. But.
No, I sort of see it a bit like the 2DS. Like my son's got one of those 2DSs, and because that's got the same issue where it's sort of like the screen is exposed, you just get a different type of carry case for it. I'm sure people will be doing that, which would be good.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. I mean, just go back to your point about you know, purchasing. You know, pre-purchasing you know, stuff for PAX. The big difference between this and a game is that you know what you're getting with PAX when you've been there like 4 or 5 times already. So I'm pretty confident it's going to be worth the purchase. It'll be fine.
Yeah,
yeah.
And there's a finite amount of tickets when there's not a finite amount of digital game sales.
That is true. That is absolutely true. Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, speaking of other sorts of digital purchases, interesting bit of news this week, which is sort of coming a couple of weeks after we talked about the Xbox. What was it? The Xbox Game Pass that Microsoft has launched with the ability to sort of download various different Xbox titles as part of a yearly subscription, or you know, you can go monthly if you want to. PlayStation followed suit with a similar thing, which is basically a whole bunch of current PS4 games coming to PlayStation Now. The difference here being that PlayStation Now as a service is a game streaming service. So you don't actually download full copies of those games to your console. You'll just be streaming it. But given that they're actually starting to put PS4 games on that, and we haven't actually had confirmation which games are going to be making it there yet, but there's a fairly good library of titles when it comes to PS4. I think, you know, when you start looking at things like Bloodborne, your Uncharted's, you know, if they put Last of Us and that kind of thing on there, games of that caliber, that's going to be a pretty big attraction for that service. It is pricier than the Xbox Game Pass, so if you want to subscribe for a year to PlayStation Now, it's currently currently $99 US, I believe, and you can do it monthly for $19.99. So that, you know, the Xbox One's basically half that. But yeah, that's interesting. So I think that they're looking at ways to compete with what Microsoft's doing, because it's become a pretty hot little combat at the moment when it comes to that digital content. And, you know, one that Nintendo has not even entered the fray yet, really. So
no,
it would be interesting.
You know why I'm not interested in the PlayStation Now news, though?
Why is that?
Because it's not available in Australia.
Oh, I actually missed that. That's got to be something that will change.
PlayStation Now is actually not available in Australia yet, so we can't actually take advantage of this news.
Oh, well. That's
just a bit sad.
Well, you know.
Go Australia.
Honestly, all the games that I want to play, I've actually purchased for PS4 anyway. So.
I found out today that Bunnings, our wonderful hardware store here in Australia, has moved to the UK. They have one store in the UK. Oh. People in the UK can online order from UK Bunnings. Oh. Australians cannot.
What?
It's a disgrace. It's a disgrace.
Up with this, I will not put.
Yep. Mm-hmm. That's just wrong. Something that's not so wrong, though. Ollie, tell us about System Shock. What's going on?
Oh, it is oh so right. So apparently, according to internet rumorings and also publishers and people talking, that System Shock 3 is apparently going to be heading to PC and consoles sometime in the hopefully not too distant future. So it's thanks to a developer or a company, I should say, called Starbreeze. So they're going to be investing some moolah into System Shock 3 and putting that together, and I'm quite excited for that. So there's no official release date yet or anything like that, but it's been quite a while since System Shock 2. So I think it's been like 16, 17 years since System Shock 2. So
I can't believe it's been that long.
Bit of a gap between games, but you know, good things come to those who wait. And then on top of that, which is really cool, is there's a reboot for the original game coming to PS4, Windows and Xbone in 2018, thanks to Night Dive Studios. And I've watched some gameplay of it, and considering what the original gameplay looked like, I like what I'm seeing, because it's not like three polygons trying to murder me on a screen. And I'm okay with that.
Nice. I actually remember something a little while back. I think it was like almost like a year ago, where someone had gone in and done like a redo of System Shock 2 using new sort of assets and stuff like that. Is this anything to do with that?
No, I think there's always a few fan ones going here and there. This is like, I think, the first like official, like actually licensed and whatnot one.
Right.
So, and yeah, it looks good. It looks good. And the sound design has always been the creepiest part of System Shock, and they've got that down pat. So
yeah,
I'm happy.
Yeah, fair enough. Other news this week, we've got a bit of Rocket League stuff heading our way. So Rocket League apparently is getting a new free mode real soon called Drop Shot. Coming on
super weird
22nd of March. Yeah, super weird. So how do you feel about an electrified ball, Ollie? Is that float your boat?
As a male, I'm against electrifying any balls ever. If that's your kink, that's fine. Don't need to know about it.
Okay, so other than the scrotal shock that Ollie was insinuating...
I'm just shocked you didn't throw that to me. Just for fun.
Yeah, I see what you did there.
You can do... Yeah, you can talk about Ollie's balls on your own time. This is totally aside from that. So, yeah, the whole idea with Drop Shot is instead of bouncing the ball to score points into your goal, basically you're going to have to break through the floor of the arena to actually create openings to score. So it sounds good on paper. Functionally, I can't wrap my head around how that will look. Does that make sense to you guys who actually are a bit more...
It does.
Yep,
yeah, it sounds cool.
Yeah. So basically you open a goal anywhere on the floor and then you have to get the ball into that goal.
It has to be in your opponent's side.
Oh,
so,
okay.
You just want to keep smashing it at the same spot, which, you know, for people with glorious aerial skills is probably going to be a piece of piss.
And do that, yep. Does that mean that if you open up a breach for a goal that the opposing team can use the same one, or is it going
to
be...
No, it has to be
on the other halves.
Opposing side.
Ah, gotcha, okay.
And then once the goal goes through, it looks like it closes up, so... Start from scratch.
Ah, that's a super interesting concept. I like the sound of that. Cool.
And apparently the harder you hit it, the more damage you do. So if you volley, and then smash it, you're more likely to do more damage.
Okay, sounds good. All right, so who out of the bunch of us is keen for some Guardians of the Galaxy action this year? You seen the trailers for the new movie?
Me.
Yep.
Yes.
So look pretty good. So if you
absolutely,
if you are very, very keen on that and do not want to wait necessarily, you can be tided over in the meantime by the new Guardians of the Galaxy game coming from Telltale this spring, this US spring. So now that indicates it's probably not too far off. They have announced the voice actors for the main cast. There's a couple of familiar names there. They've actually got Nolan North playing Rocket, which was one that caught my attention. That was interesting.
Mm.
So, yeah, Nathan Drake as Rocket Raccoon. I don't know how that works, but sure.
Yeah, I can see that. He can do character voices quite well.
Yeah.
He can voice anyone.
Well, he's pretty versatile. I mean, he did the replacement voicing for the Destiny, what are the little orb thingies called? The Travelers?
Guardians?
Yeah.
Guy.
Yeah.
Dinklebot. I can't remember the name.
Yes, he replaced Dinklebot. Yeah.
I mean,
always going to be that.
I don't know whether the voice was
Ghost.
Too much
Ghost.
The, yeah, that's ghost, it. The ghost. Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
No, Dinklebot. Yeah. Said it wrong.
Dinklebot. oh, dear.
Yeah. No, so that'll be good. It looks like they're going to be very much following comic book material as opposed to the films, which is, I guess, the reason why they've got a unique voice cast, unlike what they did with the Game of Thrones game, where they actually got a lot of the actors from the Game of Thrones TV series to sort of come on and do the voice work. So this will be a wholly different cast. But yeah, it basically, the story is going to be focusing around an artifact that they discover, which has like a huge amount of power, and everyone in the team has a good reason to want it. There'll be a big enemy who, you know, is basically stopping at nothing to try and tear it away from them as well. The enemy is described as a her, so it won't be Thanos. So it'll be something different and unique. Now, Ollie, you're pretty up on Guardians comic lore, aren't you?
I like my Marvel cosmic stuff.
Who are some of the other major villains that the Guardians have come up against that this could actually be indicating, like a female one? Is there anyone that sort of pops to the forefront of your mind?
The main ones I know is the Cancerverse and the Technovirus thing they verse.
Mm-hmm.
Generally, just any character in the Marvel cosmic can be turned into a bad guy at the drop of a hat.
Yeah.
They are good at doing that. So,
or female. Like, they're comfortable switching key elements up now for variety and a bit of surprise.
They can make Quasar into a bad guy. They can do lots of other stuff. Mm. Moondragon. Plenty.
Yeah.
Plenty of things they can do.
Cool. Well, I'm kind of excited for this. One of the things that stands out with what they've shown so far is that the art style that they've leaked, there's a few images that have gone up online, very, very different to Telltale's usual style. So Telltale have been known for doing the cell shading style with a lot of their previous games. This one is a lot more sort of 3D rendered models that look a bit more realistic. So very, very different. Very curious to see whether they've played around with the game engine or not as well after the problems I had with
I was just going to say, it's probably... Yeah.
Yeah, the Batman
still
was
on
a
their
bad
busted
experience.
Old engine, probably.
they really need to do something about that.
I actually think the Telltale formula, I think, is running a bit thin recently. I mean, I think that they, as a studio, are perhaps biting off a bit more they can chew, taking on so many projects, and they need to work on improving their engine a bit more, I think.
Yeah, quality over quantity. Mm.
Yep, I would agree. I mean, certain games carry it through a bit, I think, on story alone. Like, I definitely found that to be the case with Tales from the Borderlands. Like, the Tales from the Borderlands is relatively the same engine. There was a couple of new mechanics thrown in. Like, there was a currency mechanic and, like, a scanning type thing you could do with one of the characters' eyes. But that, like, honestly, that could have been a carbon copy engine to some of the previous games, and the story would have dragged it through for me because it was just fantastic, and I loved it. But some of the others definitely feeling that way, like the Walking Dead series in particular. I think, you know, that's one that they've got a really good opportunity to, you know, redo a little bit and freshen up. So we'll see what that actually looks like. Maybe the art style is an indication that things are going to be a little new and fresh. We will see. Now, we've got a little update on the Steam side of things. So we talked a little while back that Steam was sort of mucking around with the ways that they were tracking user reviews and sort of removing certain elements of that to create a bit more of an accurate review score. The most recent iteration of that has just happened in the last week. They've changed their review structure to basically scrub reviews that have been put in from people who haven't paid for the game. So basically now only people who have made a direct purchase from Steam are going to be able to have their overall user score counted towards what's tracked on the platform for the user reviews. So now that's an interesting one. That kind of removes anyone who has been given Steam keys for the purchase of reviews. of which I have no doubt that there's a number of legitimate reviews out there, but it kind of does wholesale remove that potential bias from people who have maybe been incentivized by getting a free copy of that code to do so, and create a situation where if you actually want like outlet reviews of Steam games now, you're probably going to want to go directly to the outlet to get that information as opposed to the Steam user reviews that are written on Steam itself. So yeah, which is an interesting one. Any thoughts on that, guys? Is that strike you as a good move or a bad move?
So you have to have purchased it through the store Steam front. If you have it on Steam from another source, it doesn't count. Like if you buy it from like a key seller, like a legit key seller, something like that, doesn't count.
That's what is being indicated. Yeah, and obviously that doesn't cover any free or free to play games. So like Dota would be different, for example. But that appears to be the plan. So, and unlike what they've done recently, it's not just a filter. It seems like this is actually going to be sort of wholesale or cut out of the scores. So, yeah, don't know about that.
I like that. I like that idea of restricting it to people who have bought the game. But I think it seems a little harsh to make it so you have to have bought the game through the Steam storefront. I think if you own the game on Steam at all from any source, I think you should be entitled to leave a review
to do that. Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I think I liked the filtering setup that they had previously. Like, I didn't mind a bunch more sort of information and the ability to pick and choose which of it is most relevant to you. Like, even if they turned around and sort of put, like, when you visit the store page for any particular game, if they had like a default setting that maybe filtered the ones out that hadn't been purchased directly from the Steam store as like the default, but you could add that back in just by tweaking a couple of settings, maybe that might be a better approach. But no, apparently they're removing it. So, yeah, I don't know. I don't think this is the last change we've seen with the Steam reviews. They seem to have been playing around with that a fair bit in the last year. So they'll probably get it right eventually. Who knows? That's an ongoing thing. All right. Now, I made an agreement to Ollie and Jam that I would not talk about a particular game tonight. So, Christian, over to you.
Sneaky bastard.
This is the dreaded H word, Hearthstone. So a couple of weeks ago, Blizzard announced the next expansion for Hearthstone, Journey to Un'Goro, which is set in the Un'Goro crater in Azeroth. Lots of dinosaurs there, I understand, and wasn't a WoW player myself. Mm-hmm. But they announced a couple of weeks ago and revealed a few cards, and then they went completely silent and didn't you know, they haven't said anything about it in a couple of weeks. And then just today, as we're recording, they have the first in a series of live action shorts they're doing, and it actually stars Danny Pudi from Community, Arbed from Community, and him playing like a little adventurer going into Un'Goro, and it's like a goofy little comedy skit, but frankly it's kind of lame. And that doesn't actually reveal anything about the game. There's no card reveals in it. They tease half a card at the end of the short. But after leaving everyone hanging for 2 weeks, they put out a kind of lame live-action short, and I think it kind of fell a bit flat. I think everyone's kind of just wants them to get on with actually revealing some cards after being silent for so long.
Yeah. Like, I tend to agree. I think it's cool that they did it, and I think, you know, getting some recognisable talent like Danny Pudi involved is cool. But I've done the maths on this, and given that we're looking at 135 cards, and given the time scale that they've left to have those revealed, we're going to get an absolute flood in the last half of this month, I think. Like, as soon as they start hitting, they're going to be hitting fast, and there's going to be a lot of them. So
Yeah.
Don't know how I feel about that sort of release leak structure. I mean, they've been criticised in the past for sort of drawing it out too long and having like a 6 to 8 week lead up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. 2 weeks just seems like, you know, a crazy amount of time. If it is indeed 2 weeks, like I think maybe 3 at most, but probably not more than that. But yeah, no, we'll see.
There's some speculation that they needed to do the initial announcement a couple of weeks ago because they wanted to add the pre-order bundle into the packet into the latest patch,
mm-hmm.
and so they needed to announce the expansion to line it up with the because they needed to have it live on the storefront, because if they didn't do it in this patch, they'd need to wait till the next one, and you know, that takes resources and time, so that they announced it a couple of weeks ago, and then haven't talked about it for a few weeks because of the way their schedule lined up. But it wasn't the sort of ideal situation.
Yeah, that's true. Probably too busy doing other things like raising prices in international currencies that aren't ours.
Yeah, that's a bit of a strange one. Mm. It's already quite an expensive hobby, but they raised it even more.
Yeah, it was only increased pack costs for Europe, I think, and some areas of Asia. Like, it's probably one of the only occasions in recent memory where we haven't been hit with an additional Australia tax, of which I'm pretty thankful for. So, we escaped it this time. Yeah. But no, it's interesting timing for that kind of thing. It's not going to affect any of the pricing for the expansion stuff, from what I understand, like the pre-orders. But of course, the packs themselves when they go live, it will. So, yeah, a little bit of angst out there at the moment, but we'll see.
We should probably spare Ollie and Jamie from more Hearthstone talk. maybe closer to Ongoro, we can have another chat, Luke.
Yeah.
Maybe do a card review or something.
Sounds good.
But
I'll be sick.
We can make our own show.
We could do that, yeah.
Party loaded deck.
With blackjack and hookers.
Yeah. Actually, that was something that I forgot to mention at the top of the show. You've been diving into...
The blackjack and hookers?
We can take that offline. Oh. That's a whole other discussion. Christian's been diving a little bit into the world of Hearthstone streaming recently, like doing the Twitch thing. So have you found that for your first couple of attempts? Yeah.
So my first couple of attempts actually went quite swimmingly. I got everything set up in OBS, and now that I've moved to an NBN area, my bandwidth could more than handle it. It was good fun. And I got, did get a few people viewing, just starting out. I didn't expect anything more than that. Kept my expectations in check. But it was nice actually having some chat interaction with people, some people actually stopping by and watching and having a chat, which was nice to see. The problem, though, is that then Zelda came out and that tore my attention away from Twitch. So I haven't actually... I did like 3 streams in a week and then Zelda came out and I haven't done any since. So yeah. I'll get back to it once I can focus on anything but Zelda. But it's been good and I do plan to do it more.
True. You can stream some Zelda. Just throw it out there.
Technically,
I've deliberately been avoiding all of the Zelda streams because I don't want to have anything spoiled for me in terms of the game mechanics. But
you don't like spoilers?
What? Yeah, I don't like me having the game spoiled.
Blissful irony.
I only like spoiling the game for you, Jamie. That's the whole point. Speaking of Zelda, Nintendo have revealed a cool little thing that they've done this week, which is a short making of series for Breath of the Wild. So now this isn't something that's particularly common with big studios until probably a little while after a game's been done. It's something we tend to see, months and months, if not years down the track. But Nintendo have actually done 3 videos. They're about 10, 11 minutes in length, which is like a quick making of series for Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild. And because a lot of this sort of activity, even predates, the death of Iwata and, development of the Switch and that kind of thing. It's quite interesting viewing, actually, sort of seeing how they dealt with a lot of the transitional change through that period. Ollie, I think this is the kind of thing that, even though you're not a massive Zelda fan, because you tend to appreciate a lot of the sort of making of type stuff, you might actually find this quite interesting. So I would recommend checking it out.
I do buy a lot of art books from various video games. So
absolutely.
Quite possible.
Yeah, there's a good bit of discussion.
I found that the shorts really quite interesting, actually, especially coming from Nintendo, who are usually quite sort of tight-lipped about their behind-the-scenes stuff. Mm. It's really good, really interesting insights into the development, and the sort of episodes focus on different things. So one is about the open world, and one is about the characters, and one is about the sort of background on how they got started on the project. There's little interesting tidbits in all of them. Like, for example, that initially they were thinking of having aliens as the antagonist. And there's a little clip in there of Link being shot at by a UFO in an early test, which is pretty funny.
Mm. Ironic, considering that the character models for some of the enemies are almost alien in nature, the way they've worked out. So there's definitely some dudes in there that look like UFOs as well.
I find it really interesting too. They do talk about like the design of the guardian enemies. They're like influenced by the Jomon period in Japanese history, like the sort of artifacts that were found during that period, which is sort of the Bronze Age, sort of late Neolithic period in Japan. If anyone knows Pokemon, then the Bronzong and Claydol are both also based on the sort of Jomon period look. And yeah, I really like how they took the sort of ancient Japanese civilization and sort of worked into the design of the enemies in Breath of the Wild. I think it works really well.
Nice. Well, that probably gives us a very convenient link in, no pun intended, to talking about the game. You were kidding yourself if you thought I was never going to use that tonight. All right, now we've got an interesting situation tonight, so we're going to do a quick review discussion of Breath of the Wild. However, Christian and I have played a significant amount. Jamie and Ollie have not. So the role of you guys tonight is effectively to be the audience that we would almost be sort of, I guess, speaking to if we were selling them the idea of the game and sort of what is good about it. Now, one of the discussions has been popping up a lot recently, and I think it's both good and bad, but I think it's probably relevant in this case because it'll connect to you two with recent understanding, is, of course, comparing it to other open-world games that have been quite big recently, and, you know, of course, Horizon Zero Dawn's been mentioned a few times. Probably doesn't hurt to do some comparisons when it comes to open-world games, because I think there's probably a bit we can talk to with regards to Breath of the Wild. But we'll see how we go, and you guys dive in and ask questions as it comes up, and we'll see what we can reveal without spoiling for anyone else. So,
sure.
Yeah. All right. So, general Zelda franchise info. Now, I was chatting to Jam and Ollie a few days ago about the Zelda franchise and my perspective on it. And Christian, you might be able to explain this better, but the way I kind of came around to it was that as a franchise, the story is very all over the place. Like, it's almost, the comparison I used was almost Final Fantasy-esque in the way that in Zelda sort of continuity, there's a lot of, messed around timelines, and the continuity from game to game is all over the place and sometimes exists, sometimes doesn't. Sometimes you really need to stretch to sort of join those dots. But like Final Fantasy, there are some continuing elements that tend to pop up a lot in Zelda games. Like, you know, Final Fantasy, you'll play an FF game and you'll recognize that usually there's chocobos, usually there's, you know, materia, some animu hair, like huge weapons,
Guardian
Forces, Gaia, that kind of thing. With Zelda, you can typically expect
Moogles.
Yeah, exactly. You know, those common elements. So Zelda, you can typically expect Link, you know, to be the hero in pretty much all the Zelda games. You can typically expect Princess Zelda to be involved somehow. Hence the namesake. There's usually a fight with Ganon most of the time. There's a few other enemies that are introduced.
Usually involving a Triforce.
Usually involving a Triforce, yep. That's usually a pretty keen theme. There's often a Master Sword. There's often dungeons of some sort that are key to progression through the game, obtaining items of some variety. And, fairies are another pretty common one in Zelda games. There's a few things that pop up quite a bit. So, but that being said, it's not like we could plot a clear path between, you know, what is the first Zelda game in terms of story. It's not even like the Metal Gear series where, like, as messed up as the Metal Gear stories are, you can actually plot a chronological course through those games. With Zelda, I don't think you can.
Yeah.
So
Zelda, there have been some attempts in recent years by Nintendo to organize the timeline a bit. So initially, absolutely, the games weren't designed with a timeline in mind. They were just reimagining reiterations of Zelda, those core elements of the Zelda franchise. It was actually Skyward Sword was the first Zelda game they designed with an official timeline in mind, and they released a book called The Hyrule Historia that actually went back and explained where every other game fits into the timeline. And Skyward Sword actually is placed at the beginning of the timeline, so it is the first chronological game is Skyward Sword. But the timeline is absolutely messed up. So it's got all sorts of branches. Like, for example, Ocarina of Time, there's a branch where young Link dies and then this goes on to this game. There's a branch where young Link succeeds but doesn't become old Link, and then it goes on to this game. And there's a branch where Link becomes old and succeeds. And so it's this hideous, messy tree. It's impossible to memorize. But there is some structure to it, and people have been trying to figure out where Breath of the Wild fits in, and it is a bit of a puzzle. But there are definitely links back to the older games in it, some that I won't spoil. One in particular that I actually love, really cool link to an older game, but
nice,
won't spoil.
You almost don't need to link them to the other games. I think each of them stands on its own pretty effectively if you want to play it like that, so which is good.
Definitely.
And I would say that Breath of the Wild is a good entry point to the franchise if you even wanted to ignore the story a lot of the previous ones too. I think it's fine. A lot of it is explained. All right, so Christian, you want to give us a crack at what you would describe the overall sort of setting and basic story of Breath of the Wild? So where are we at this time?
So the overall setting setting and story of Breath of the Wild, it's actually somewhat post-apocalyptic. Mm-hmm. So the idea is that you as Link have awoken 100 years after the destruction of the Kingdom of Hyrule. That basically, 100 years ago, the bad guy Ganon, he came back and he won, essentially. And Link was sort of put into a stasis. This is all explained in the initial sort of 30 seconds of the game. That's not really a spoiler.
He was
placed into like a stasis, and he comes out 100 years later, and he has his memory wiped, as all good JRPG protagonists and Japanese game protagonists do. They have their memory wiped. And then, yeah, so you're sort of out in the wild world recovering your memories and figuring out a way to right the wrongs of the past and defeat Ganon once and for all.
Yeah. It's an interesting story mechanic too with regards to the memory loss, because as you sort of go around and retrieve some of those memories, it's a really good, structured method of pacing the story leading up to this point without bombarding you in one hit with it.
Totally.
Yeah. So it works pretty well like that.
Yeah. I think it's great. It doesn't bombard you in one hit with it. And the other thing it allows for is that there can be a problem in open world games, I find, where the pacing feels strange, where you'll talk to a character in the game and they'll be like, you know, you need to go kill this dragon straight away because it's going to destroy the world. But with Zelda, you're sort of left to your own devices more, and there's not like a pressing overarching story that you have to go and address. Most of the story is told through the memories, and so it doesn't feel, there's no like ludonarrative dissonance, they call it, like disconnect between the gameplay and the storytelling. I feel like it feels more natural. It doesn't feel like you're going and running and collecting 10 crickets when you are supposed to be saving the world.
Yeah, absolutely.
I much prefer that.
So, yeah, I guess that's a really good contrast with a lot of other open world games. Now, one of the other big contrasts, and this becomes immediately obvious within probably the first hour of playing, is that Breath of the Wild, for a Zelda game, is completely devoid of the rails that you would often expect to find even in the most liberal open world games. Like, you know, if you look at any open world game that typically has some sort of quest structure or story progression, usually you'll get some pretty firm direction on how to learn the different skills that you need to succeed and how to progress onto the next sort of story beat. And, you know, even though there's a lot of option to sort of, you know, venture beyond that and explore how you want, usually there is a pretty obvious path to take. Breath of the Wild, really not the case. Like, you can literally, and this has been done now because we've seen that there's been a new world record set for the speed run this last week. I think it's under an hour, or just over an hour is what's been set.
Yeah, just under an hour.
Yeah, which is crazy.
That's like, silly.
We knew this was going to happen, but yeah, it was kind of cool to see it happen. Like, once you sort of get out of the opening area in Breath of the Wild, you can literally go to the final, like, end boss area, which is where you can battle Calamity Ganon and take on the end game boss immediately. Like, there's nothing preventing you from wandering into the hardest areas of the map besides, you know, just getting your ass smashed. But, you know, if you are super skilled or if you want a challenge that's not going to have you tearing your hair out, then, you know, you could do it, theoretically. It's cool that it lets you do that. But my first hour with the game was just complete unshackled freedom. It felt great. It was a really different kind of experience. Like, just working out some of the freedoms of the game and the things that it doesn't tell you was, you think that it would be frustrating, like not getting a lot of direction or instruction into some of the basic gameplay elements and functions within the game, like how weapons work and how this works and that works. But it was so liberating. It was a great thing, and it was totally unexpected. So what was your experience with that?
It's one of those games where feeling, getting lost, like physically, that feels good. Like, it being like alone in the wild and not knowing what you're supposed to do, where you're supposed to go, and the atmosphere is so well designed in the game that you can be doing nothing whatsoever and it still feels like an adventure. And it also has a clever way of putting you in a tutorial but not actually telling you you're in a tutorial. So that initial area, you feel like you've got the entire world open to you, but you're actually stuck on that plateau. And then once you leave that starting area, that's when the true open world begins. But it doesn't feel like you're in a tutorial at the start. It doesn't doesn't come up with constant prompts saying, this is how you do this, this is how you do this. It just gives you a bit of a walled garden to begin with, and then opens you up to the wider sort of forest.
That's a really good way to describe it, actually. There was one area in that opening plateau that was pretty obviously meant as a big learning curve to get into. And I think I described this last week on the show where I sort of said there was like a cold area, like a mountainous area where it was so cold that unless you actually had some food to keep you warm or other items, you basically go in there and start taking damage instantly. So that, you know, the way around that is I had to work out how to cook, and that was almost like, you know, kind of that sort of invisible rails where it's like, okay, this is the game's way of teaching you how the cooking function works because you need to do it to get this part done. So, and you know, mucking around with.
You can go there with a torch as well, though. If you're holding a lit torch, that gives you enough warmth to get by as well. But it makes fighting difficult, but you can do it.
I did not know that. There you go. That's really interesting.
Yeah.
That is cool. But yeah, there's hundreds of things like that are really cleverly sort of inserted little teaching points, but totally not obvious, which makes the game feel great because it makes it feel like you have all the agency and you're doing it as you want to, so which is cool.
Totally.
I mean, as an open world game, now Jam and Ollie, this is a really good sort of point of comparison, which I think is a good one to illustrate one of the things about the open world setting that I love about Zelda that I didn't like about Horizon.
Can I guess what it might be?
Yeah, go for it, go.
Is it related to swimming or climbing?
It is, in fact, related to swimming and climbing.
Yeah, because that was going to be one of my questions.
Twist.
I've heard very interesting things, and I'm very curious.
Well, look, don't get me wrong. Both of those things can be frustrating as hell in Breath of the Wild. But the way it works is, I mean, in Horizon and a lot of other open world games, and Skyrim is a particular, you know, culprit for this kind of thing with the hop jumping sort of mechanic where, you know, there's different areas of the mountainside or the terrain, which, you know, is built to allow you to jump on it sort of on incremental pieces or not. And you often have to sort of just jump around blindly and see if your feet can gain purchase and actually progress further or not. With Breath of the Wild, you can literally climb on just about any surface unless it is like smooth metal, I think, prevents you. And when it's raining as well. Yeah. Like if it actually starts raining, there's like slick rock that doesn't let you climb it. So that's an interesting one too, because climbable surfaces in this game, depending on the different weather conditions, can suddenly become unclimbable. And that can be a bit of a shit at times.
I was really impressed with the rain that it actually has like rain occlusion, where if there's an overhanging rock that you can actually, even when it's raining, you can climb up like uninhindered if it's actually overhanging, so if the terrain's covering the rain. Yep. But once you sort of crest around the edge and get it back into the rain, then you'll start slipping. But I like that it actually goes to the detail of having the rain occlusion.
Yeah, it's cool. Amazing.
It's cool. It really does open up the terrain a lot more as well. But the fact that you can climb on pretty much any surface to get just about anywhere, the only limitation is that you have a stamina wheel. So you have like a little green wheel that basically gradually depletes as you're doing any sort of physical activity. And that includes running, that includes swimming, and that includes climbing. And with climbing, the impact of that's pretty obvious, because if you run out of stamina when you're on the side of a mountain, you will fall to your death basically. So absolutely, you want to be careful of that.
Sounds amazing.
Swimming's not so much, because if you run out of stamina while you're swimming, it'll usually sort of game over you but put you at the shore, like the edge of the water, so it's not quite as punishing. Running out of stamina when you're running basically just causes you to slow and catch your breath before you can sort of run again. So, you know, when you're trying to run away from things, you want to, you know, tap the run button as opposed to letting it go all the way depleted, because then you will sort of have to catch your breath. But one of the sort of upgrades that you get as you progress through the game is actually the ability to increase the length of your stamina wheel. Like it starts to build on a secondary wheel over the top of the first one to increase it in length before it drains. So different areas of the map actually become more accessible as you increase that, and becomes easier to sort of increase your climbing distance and the amount of leeway it gives you when you're trying to find like platforms between climbing areas. So
that's a really cool feature.
Cool. You can also cook food that can replenish your stamina wheel mid-climb. So if you're determined enough, you can actually climb anywhere right at the start of the game. So there's one area called Dueling Peaks, I think it is, and it's like a massive mountain, and it's quite an early area, but it seemed unclimbable at my point in the game, but I was determined to get to the top of it, so I cooked up a bunch of meals that would replenish my stamina, went on an expedition, and sure enough, after, you know, a rickety climb and eating four meat skewers laced with stamina drugs. I got to the top of it, and there's like an awesome shrine at the top waiting for me, which was wicked. So
nice.
No growth hormone.
No, I can just picture Link.
Yeah,
climbing up the side of the mountain, just stopping every few moments just to snort another line of coke and keep going. He's just like on the way up.
yeah, totally. Oh,
nice. No, it's cool.
Why do you have to ruin this beautiful thing?
Oh man, there's plenty in this game to ruin a beautiful thing. No, it's good.
So much to ruin.
Yeah, I know. I've got so much to ruin in this game. It's gonna be great. There is one item that you get reasonably early on, which is basically like a hang gliding sort of kit, which allows you to climb to great heights and then literally just jump off the top and just glide down onto other areas of the map. And I think that that's an almost like vitally necessary element of this whole thing, because the ability to climb is great, but it's very, very slow going most of the time. You can jump while you're climbing, and that allows you to sort of, you know, I guess speed up the process of climbing up. You can kind of, you know, hop, skip and jump a little bit at speed. It depletes your stamina bar quicker than it would if you climbed that distance normally, though, so it's a bit of a, you know, calculated.
It's good for a last push.
Yeah, it's a calculated decision as to whether you want to sort of shortcut or not at a cost. But when you get up to the top and can actually glide off the top of big mountains, that's a good way of covering a lot of distance quickly. So it's almost worth the time investment to do that, which is cool. So
there's also a set of climbing gear armor that increases your climbing speed too. So if you fortunate enough to find the full set of that, then you actually climb at quite a faster pace.
Yeah.
Which is pretty cool.
Nice. Yeah, so let's talk about some of the other open world weirdness, because I think there's a bunch of it in this game, and it's we've talked a little bit in the past about this thing called emergent gameplay, which is almost like when people have worked out ways to do things in game that you know, the developers haven't necessarily intended themselves, and you know, completely accidental ways of not so much breaking the game but finding out new ways to do things. I've seen some interesting ones on YouTube popping up this week, and there was one in particular around one of the abilities that you've got. It's like a stasis ability where you can actually cast a stasis effect as like a runic magic power on solid objects like boulders, and then you basically can hit them repeatedly with something while they're in stasis to build up their kinetic energy, and then as soon as you release the stasis lock, it flies off in whatever direction you've been knocking it towards. And what someone actually managed to do that I saw a clip of is they basically hit this boulder with the stasis ability, struck it a whole bunch of times with their weapon, and then they climbed up onto it before the effect sort of ran out, and then as soon as it did, the boulder would just rocket off across the landscape with them clinging onto the back of it. So it was almost like a way to speed up your travel across the map. And that sort of stuff is amazing. Like, you would not expect anyone to come
up
with that.
So good.
It's just, it's nuts.
There are so many fun ways you can break the physics like that and do like unintended things, like you're saying, emergent things. It's so fun. And because there's so many different systems with like the wind and fire and the stasis and the magnetism. It's like this awesome toolbox of abilities that you can put together in different ways and do all sorts of things. It's fantastic.
Yeah. I think we've spoken before about the whole chopping down a tree strategy and rolling it across a mock goblin camp as just an example of fun ways you can take out enemies. I had another one that I chanced on today, which was hilarious. So, you know, we mentioned the weather conditions. Now, there is actually a couple of really interesting weather conditions in this game. One of them is a lightning storm. So, and I experienced this for the first time today. So if it actually starts to thunder in the distance in this game and it's raining, it's basically like a bit of a warning that there's a chance of lightning striking. Now, if you look in your inventory when that's the case, you'll actually see a whole bunch of the items in your inventory that have metal components that actually have like a lightning sort of effect playing over the image of them. And that's a warning for you that if you're actually equipped with any of those items, that you've actually got a chance, and it's a very, very good chance of being hit by lightning. So after getting struck by lightning because I was carrying a metal shield and basically it one-shotted me and killed me dead, I realized what was up, and I thought, huh, okay, this is interesting. Let's see if we can find ways to break this. I wandered into a mock goblin camp while a whole bunch of them were asleep during a lightning storm. I threw down a metal sword onto the ground next to them and then wandered off, and lightning struck the camp and killed a bunch of them. It was awesome.
Nice. Oh, dude, that's so awesome. I had such a similar experience to that. It's so good. Where I managed to find an item where it's a helmet that makes you immune to electricity. Mm-hmm. And so I did a similar thing, but I just walked into the middle of my goblin camp and stood there and waited for myself to get struck by lightning, knowing that I'm immune. And everyone around me just went flying.
That's wicked.
Holy crap. That's evil.
Oh, that's so good.
Yeah, the stuff it does is amazing. So, yeah, it's great. You can climb trees to, pick apples off them and get beehives. And there's even bird's nests with eggs in them in the odd tree as well, which I've just discovered. So that was cool.
Like throw the eggs in hot water and get hard-boiled eggs. Yeah, and
it's awesome, yeah. So, the open world activity really, they've put a lot of thought into it, and there's a lot of stuff that is not obvious. And I think it's really intuitive. Like, if you try something in this game that you think should actually, because of physics and, logically be possible, chances are it actually works. Like, most of the time I found that it does, which is totally weird. Like, it's not something you'd expect from a game like this. You'd think there'd be a lot more limitations in place, but they've done a great job with capturing, every player's imagination with what they can try. So that's really, really impressive. So, the open world activity, I think, is probably far and above, for me, the thing that really sells this game. I think they've done a fantastic job with the open world elements, and I think a lot of other games are almost going to have the opportunity to look at this and take note and wonder what they can achieve if they take some of the rails off and let players just go nuts and not give them too much sort of scripted instruction. It's a good indication of what is achievable when you don't treat people like idiots, basically. So, there you go. Now, we mentioned...
Which is the exact opposite to Skyward Sword.
Yeah, that is true.
Which was the most hand-holdy Zelda game in history.
Yeah, it wasn't the intro, like a really, really long and drawn-out sort of example of that as well, where people just got fed up and wanted to jump into
Absolutely.
The game. Yeah, yeah.
The intro was super long, and you had a helper character that lived in your sword, and she would jump out and remind you of things incessantly. She'd say, "You've been playing for a few hours. Why don't you take a break?" And then every time you pick up an item for the first time after you've turned your game on and off, she'll, "Hey, this is a rupee. Rupees are money. You can spend them in shops." And it's just like, "I know, lady, leave me alone. All right, I'm 30 hours into this game. I'm good with the rupees."
Actually, this is bringing back a lot of memories, because I remember at the time that game came out, there was a lot of memes appearing online with Link carrying around the Microsoft Office paperclip.
Basically. Oh, yeah, totally.
Doing that sort of thing, yeah. Now, one thing that we've mentioned already, which sort of bears a little bit more explanation, is one of the abilities you've got in this game, apart from your standard weapons and combat and that sort of thing, is you've got these runic powers, which are basically like a short list of magic abilities you can use. Now, these aren't necessarily just offensive in nature. They're mostly used for solving puzzles and various different physics challenges. So there's four main ones that you sort of start off with. And this isn't really a spoiler because of how early in the game it is. And it's so, integral to the way the game plays. So you have an ice ability, which basically allows you to create a column of ice in any sort of water area. So you can do it in open water or any area where there's a bit of dampness on the ground or sort of flowing water. You can actually create these objects. They can serve to actually push things up out of the water. They can serve to basically give you cover from enemies when you're in combat. You can use them as climbing surfaces. So you can actually create like an ice pillar, which allows you to climb the ice pillar and jump off it onto other things. Or it can actually block the flow of water as well if you do it in certain locations. So there's a whole bunch of different utilities for that one. You've also got the stop time one, which we mentioned before. So you can actually sort of focus in on various different things. Usually the things that can be affected by these runic abilities are highlighted when you activate the ability. And it's limited to certain objects in any given area of the map. So you can't do it on everything. But you lock whatever you're targeting in place. And you can basically use that to lock something in place and move around it or past it. Or, if it's like a pressure switch, for instance, that you don't want activated, you could lock it in place and then whatever you're doing doesn't trigger it, that kind of thing. You can use it to do the kinetic energy trick that we mentioned before. So if you lock something in place and actually hit it a bunch of times, you can actually fire it off in whatever direction you've been hitting it in when the effect sort of elapses. And that's a really cool, interesting thing you can do with it. Christian, you want to take the other two? We've got the...
Yeah, so there's two types of bombs that you get. And unlike previous Zelda games, they're not a collectible resource. So you don't need to have like a bomb pouch with 20 bombs in. You Link just regenerates them on a recharge timer, and there's a round one and a square based one. So the round ones are ideal for rolling down hills and using like like curved environments to predict where the path that the bomb's going to go and use that to your advantage. And the square-based ones are more suited to just plonking them down next to an object and they won't roll away. They'll just blow up straight, you know, blow up where you put them down. And the other tool is the magnesis. So anything in the game that's metal, including like weapons and like metal blocks, metal treasure chests, all sorts of things, Link can actually remotely sort of magneto style manipulate them and move them around. And you can do all sorts of wicked things with that. Like you can pick up a metal treasure chest and it's in the middle of a goblin camp and just start swinging it around and smashing into all the enemies. You can like lift a metal crate up above an enemy and then just let it go and it'll drop down and smash on their head. You can find hidden objects that are like on riverbeds if they're metal and like pull them up like sword from the lake style. Yeah, and there's all sorts of wicked things you can do with the magnetic powers.
Yeah, it's good, and you get all this stuff very, very early in the game too. So, they're
yeah, you can upgrade them.
Yeah,
later. Mm.
But they're handy. Like I spend a whole bunch of the early part of the game running around and literally dropping bombs behind me, letting them explode on dudes that were chasing me. So, you know, just so I didn't have to spend any weapons and that kind of thing.
Totally.
Which is cool. So yeah, combat in the game. Combat's really interesting. It's probably the most different combat I've ever seen in a Zelda game, and it at times it can get super hard. So probably the most immediately jarring thing for newcomers to Breath of the Wild is that the weapons and equipment that you get take damage and actually do break, and a lot of it happens quite quickly. So you churn through weapons at a fairly good clip in the early game. As time goes on, you do sort of get better quality weapons that take longer to break, and there's very different things you can get to sort of offset that quite a bit. But in the early game, like you're picking up things and they're breaking after a few hits. Like if you smash down a skeletal sort of creature, and you can actually pick up its arm as a weapon, like a club, and
brilliant.
Yeah, you can run around with that and actually beat dudes to death with it, and it breaks after like four or five hits, and it tracks damage in your inventory, and you can actually see whether it's flashing red or not and that kind of thing, which is interesting. But it is frustrating at times, because one of the challenges in this game, especially in the early game, is that you do have a very limited inventory, and because you can only carry around certain weapons, and different weapons have different effects in game too. Like you ideally want to carry around like an axe for cutting down trees, because you might need to drop a log over a chasm so you can actually get to an area. You probably want to carry around like a hammer, so you can actually knock bits of rocks apart to get like precious ores and things, and that takes another slot and that sort of thing. So you do have a limited capacity for carrying all these weapons, and you want to carry good stuff, but you don't necessarily want to use your good weapons on the lowly sort of open world enemies that you fight, because then you're kind of wasting them when your weapons are going to be degrading and breaking down. So it's a real challenge to decide how you want to deal with that. And I don't know. Yeah. I haven't actually found a good balance with that. Have you been finding it, Christian?
Yeah, I think early on it can be a bit of a frustration. It may have been nice if they'd perhaps like separated tools from weapons and had like separate inventory slots for tools and weapons maybe. Later, as you progress, you do have the ability to upgrade that inventory. There's by solving environmental puzzles. So there's actually 900 sort of mini environmental puzzles in the game and the open world,
oh,
and by solving
all?
Those you get only 900. You get a currency that you can use to spend to upgrade your inventory slots, and that combined with the stronger weapons taking longer to break does ease up on that slight frustration a bit. But I do like the system overall, and I'm glad that you can't repair weapons, because it forces you to try new things, and it avoids that situation that can happen in loot-based games where you get one sword that's just better than everything else you find, and then all loot becomes pointless and you just repair that sword and then you lose interest in everything else. But this game forces you to try things you hadn't tried before, and to always sort of be on a bit of a treadmill trying new weapons, which I actually think is quite cool.
Yeah, and the different weapons have different attack speeds too, so that's actually something you want to consider when you're considering which one to take into a fight. So something might hit harder, but it hits a lot slower. And your different sort of length weapons, like your pole arms and things, do give you a greater attack range, but they can be a bit more unwieldy in different ways. So it is actually a decision to make. It's not like a no-brainer. That being said, though, haven't found a Master Sword yet, so I'm sure that when we actually uncover that might be... That can't be a breakable weapon, surely. can't be.
It's out there. I could tell you if you want.
No, don't tell me. That's all good.
I might leave that as a surprise.
Yeah. I did pick up a trident weapon, which can actually be repaired by a character in the game. So that might be one of the exceptions. I'm sure there's probably a few sort of, notorious or famous weapons out there that you can do that kind of thing with. But, again, they'll still degrade over time. Look, it's just one of those mechanics in the game. It's a bit frustrating at times, but yeah, I don't know. It's a thing.
I will just say with the Master Sword, The one thing I say with the Master Sword is that the way that you get it is awesome.
Okay, cool.
It's a really wicked way of getting it. I'll let you experience it, but I think it's really interesting. Yeah.
Sweet. There's some really interesting moves you can use in combat to sort of get out of trouble too. Like a lot of the stuff that you fight is a lot bigger than you are. So some of the attack patterns and sword sweeps are just huge, like in terms of the amount of area they cover. So you can actually lock onto enemies and jump out of the way of them. And if you time it right, you can actually sort of run in and do like a flurry of blows sort of as you do it. And to actually beat some of the different bosses, it's almost essential to master that technique. And it does require some pretty split-second timing. So one of the things I found was quite interesting about this game, particularly in combat with some of the main boss fights, is that there's actually a big difficulty spike. Like you're fighting some of the open world gribblies, and they're very, very low level and not particularly difficult. But when you get to some of the boss type creatures, they are super hard. Like I'm actually thinking about whether my sons would actually do all right playing this game or not. And I think for the most part, they'd be okay out in the open environment. When it comes to some of the boss creatures, I think that they would have a big struggle with that. It's something that you'd need to sink a bunch of time into. So, yeah.
Have you come across a Lionel? They're sort of like the lion centaur guys?
No, I've seen pictures, but I haven't come across one personally yet.
The first time I fought one of those, it was literally a Dark Souls boss fight where I retried maybe 15 times and had to fight it perfectly. The game has a system where if you perfectly time a dodge, you go into like a slow-mo and you can do a flurry attack. Or if you perfectly time a parry, you can do the same thing, opens up the enemy. And this boss fight, I just had to play it perfectly, and it was really satisfying, just like beating, Capra Demon in Dark Souls or something like that.
Yeah, exactly. The different mechanics that you need to work out and stuff, so... Yeah, we could talk all night about those sorts of mechanics. We'll keep it brief. There's a lot to the combat. The methods of progression during the game are quite interesting. Like there's no experience points, there's no leveling so much. You basically will increase the amount of stamina that you've got on that wheel that we mentioned before, and increase the number of hearts that you got, which is basically your health. Aside from that, picking up certain items of equipment, like certain vital items that give you abilities, like there's a set of armor that improves the way that you kind of swim and allows you to do some funky stuff there. You mentioned the climbing gear. I get the impression that none of that is particularly sort of vital for completing the game. It probably just gives you different avenues of increasing your chances or giving you an advantage.
Just more tools.
Yeah, exactly. Like it's not gated equipment for a method of describing it. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, it's not like the old games where you need to get the hook shot to get to this area, or you need to get the boomerang to do this. It's all just sort of aiding what you can already do.
Yeah, essentially, which is cool. Now, the other big thing that you spend a lot of time doing in this game is exploring shrines. Now, shrines are like mini dungeons that are usually, usually four rooms-ish, sometimes a little less, sometimes a little longer. But the shrines are basically puzzle areas. So most of them are physics-style puzzles. So you'll go in and you'll use your runic abilities to solve different sort of challenges. It might involve sort of, creating ice blocks to sort of navigate over a water area, sort of completing mazes like that. Using the magnetic powers to sort of, turn cogs and wheels and, create mechanism, doors opening, things like that. There's a whole bunch of different styles of them. Some of them are a hell of a lot more challenging than others. But like one of the funnest parts of the game is running around and completing those shrines, because for every four of them you complete, you actually get to sort of increase like your hearts or increase your stamina. So, doing them in groups of four is something that you spend a fair bit of time doing. It's a lot of fun. So, yeah.
You compared them last week to Portal, and that's so true. They're test chambers. There's like, I think it's 120 in total. There's 120 test chambers in Hyrule. Wow. It's fantastic.
Jesus.
I didn't actually realize there was that many. That's incredible.
That's huge.
Yeah.
I've done 70, and there's 120. And some of them, most of them are the like physics puzzles. Some of them are like sort of lateral thinking or like just pattern recognition. Some of them are combat challenges, yep. So there is a bit of variety, but most of them are physics.
Yeah, which is cool. I like that they're short too. Like you can actually sit down and bust one out in a good sort of 10 to 15 minutes. Like it's not a huge playtime commitment. So if you wanted to hop on and play some Zelda for a quick spell, like just running in and doing a shrine is a good way to sort of have like a short session as opposed to sort of getting lost in the open world. That's good fun. Like using the Switch model, if someone was going to play this game on the go, like on public transport or something like that, jumping in and doing a shrine would be a good use of that time, I think.
It would be cool.
Oh, and can I just quickly mention with the shrines, the one thing I love about the tower system in the game had like the discovery aspect, because some people have criticized the game for having the classic open world. You find the tall tower, it reveals a part of the map that sort of Ubisoft's been famous for doing for a while. But I think that the reason that it's works so well in Breath of the Wild is that when you reach these towers, it colours in the topography of the map but doesn't reveal the location of anything within that area. You actually have to visibly look from the tower and mark with your scope, like set pins in every point of interest you can see. So yeah, it doesn't actually just say here are all the hunting grounds, here are all the shrines, blah 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 blah. You still have to discover that stuff. It just fills in the topography. Yeah.
And not all of them are visible from those towers either. Like sometimes it is in your best interest to just climb the nearest mountain and see what you can see. So which is super cool. Yeah, like the whole map stuff with the game, and we should probably mention as well, the map is freaking massive. Like for an open world game, Zelda,
it's enormous.
It sounds huge.
Yeah, like
in that making of short, they mentioned it's 12 times the size of Twilight Princess.
Wow.
Which was the prior largest open world.
Yeah, that's incredible. Oh, man, that is huge. I have, as far as the towers go, I've explored 4 sections of the map, and that's, like, not even close to a third of it. So, yeah, I've got a whole bunch to go. So, UI is generally pretty good. The biggest frustration I've got with the way the whole user interface works is mostly with the inventory stuff. And because I'm playing on Wii U, the increase in frustration for me is the fact that this game could have been so much better in that regard if they had have actually made use of the split screen gamepad option. But they've obviously not done that because the Switch wouldn't allow for it. So it's almost like they've stripped it out of the Wii U for the sake of making both of the games the same sort of experience. But God damn it would have been so great. Like it would have fixed all of those niggles if they had have actually allowed you to do that stuff on the Wii U gamepad screen. Because you know the fact that your inventory is so limited and you need to go in quite a bit for swapping out weapons and doing your cooking with your foods and that sort of stuff. Just being able to do that on a separate screen would add so much good to this game. But they've
It would have been so much better.
It was probably. If I was going to have one major knock against it would be that. And I mean, sadly for me, that's probably what makes it a less than perfect game because I think that actually is a significant downside. But it's still phenomenal and it's better every other way. So, yeah.
Did we want to just run through quickly a few sort of like negative things or things we don't like?
Yeah,
so
you
much?
Go, you go.
Because I've got a couple I'd like to mention. So I just want like the performance on Switch isn't fantastic. Like when you're playing it on the docked mode, sometimes it does frame drop into the sort of low 20s, probably even high teens in certain areas. So it's not a smooth frame rate. In the portable mode, it's actually, funnily enough, a better performance because it's downscaled to 720p as opposed to the 900p on the docked mode. So it actually runs a bit smoother in portable mode than it does on the TV. So that's one little knock I'd give against it. And the other thing I would mention is the voice acting in the game isn't stellar. I think that it's passable, but not great voice acting.
I think that's probably it almost comes down to your expectations of a Zelda game when it comes to that kind of thing. Because I would go into almost any Zelda game and not expecting any VO because it's not something that the series is particularly known for.
This is the first time. Yeah.
So the fact that there is some is kind of new. And I would agree it's not great. But going from not expecting any.
I appreciate that it's in there. Yeah. I was really looking forward to sort of the Zelda world being brought to life in that way, and they've pulled it off really well. I just for everything else, the game's kind of like a 10 out of 10 and the voice acting kind of like an 8 or a 7 out of 10 maybe, so it's still good. But it would have just completely polish the package. That's not a euphemism. If it was 10 out of 10.
One Nintendo. Polish his package.
Polish your package, yeah, that's it.
Yeah please.
Sound VO. I mean, the musical score is beautiful. Really atmospheric. Fits the Zelda theme beautifully.
It's so good. They made such a smart decision in this by shying away from an orchestral score. So it's the key instrument is piano. And it's much more low key. There's very few sort of sweeping overtures in the game at all. It's much more used to enhance the ambient noises. The music is subtle and beautiful.
Yeah, it's great. Graphics are pretty obvious. I think it's that really interesting almost cel-shaded sort of art style, which actually does work very well for this game, and I think it's probably a great fit for the Switch too, because when you're playing on that smaller size screen, the art style in contrast to something like the hyper detail of Horizon Zero Dawn is much better for that smaller sort of area of real estate visually. So I think that's great.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
It works well with the aesthetic. It's again, it's different to other Zelda games, but I think that there hasn't been a huge amount of continuity with regards to the Zelda art style. It has sort of reinvented itself a number of times depending on which platform it's been on. So yeah
it's closest to Skyward Sword in its style, but a bit less pastel. Skyward Sword was almost like a watercolor painting, and Breath of the Wild's kind of halfway between that and Twilight Princess, which was the most like gritty, realistic looking one.
All right, well, I mean, that's largely our thoughts on the game, I guess. Do you have any sort of other particular highlights from personal experience that you wanted to call out before we sort of give a bit of a wrap up? Anything that stands out?
If I was going to mention one last thing, it would be how awesome I think the character Princess Zelda is in the game. Not to give away any story spoilers, but I really like the treatment of Zelda in this game, namely that she is a multi-layered character and actually has internal struggle, and she's actually quite a scientist in some ways, which I think is really cool. And she's quite a tomboy. Her main character design, she's wearing riding pants, for example. So she's not a girly princess in it, which I think is really cool.
Yeah, she's not the damsel in distress that you would expect as the stereotype.
Not at all. No.
Which is good. Yeah, I had a really cool thing that happened today where I was running across a bridge, and I was going to take a leap off to get down to an area below, and a dude, another character, a Harleen character on that bridge, actually tried to talk me down from it, like he was trying to stop me from committing suicide.
Yeah.
I sort of saw
That's
that.
So
and
cool.
Then later in the day, I actually saw there was an article somewhere about that exact same area of the game, and I read it and realized
too.
That what it was, and I was like, man, that is cool. That is awesome.
Sweet.
Suicide prevention in Zelda.
The writing in the game is really quite sweet. It is there's a lot of funny little moments and touching little moments, just things that NPCs say. And a surprising number of characters are actually super horny for Link as well, which is really weird.
Yeah.
there's a lot of
male and female
characters coming on to Link and calling him cute and stuff, and it's pretty funny.
Yeah,
awesome.
It is good. So Jam, there is one thing that I think that you'll appreciate. You can actually capture a horse in this game and actually tame it to ride. So it doesn't just behave automatically. You actually have to train the damn thing by giving it pats on the head when it does the right thing and all that sort of stuff.
Aww.
And different,
you can feed it apples.
Yeah, you feed it and stuff, and different types of horse sort of hide, like whether it's plain color or mottled, actually have different behavior characteristics as well. But you can actually style up your horse after you stable it and change the mane color and all that sort of stuff. And
fabulous.
Jamie was never seen
again. I thought that would be fancy.
There's legendary mounts too. If you played Red Dead, then it's a situation like that where you can get the legendary animals.
Sweet.
And there's some a skeleton horse and a forest spirit looking thing and all sorts of cool. I got the descendant of the royal horse. It's Princess Zelda's mount from 100 years ago or whatever. It's really cool. It's a pretty white horse.
Oh, that's awesome.
I called it Diana.
Nice.
Lovely.
All right, well, I think it's probably pretty clear that that we both really, really like this game. So now, given that Ollie, you and Jam have sort of just been listening to us rave on about this for the last period, so do you two want to give us your desire to play this game based on what we've said and any concerns that you would have from the perspective of the audience in this case? So what are your thoughts?
I want to play the game because it sounds like you can do everything you would be able to in a realistic scenario. So it doesn't, yes, it's a game, but it doesn't sound gamey. It's not like, ping, you got 50 coins and stuff. It's, no, I chopped a tree down and rolled a log through a goblin camp.
Yep.
Metal attracts lightning. I'm immune to lightning. I walk in and get electrocuted. This makes perfect sense.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I have a magnet thing. I pull a sword out of the bottom of a lake. That sounds really cool to me. Like, that's the biggest appeal, is that open worldness. Not to sound rude, but I don't really know or feel anything for the Zelda story, so that's not a big draw for me. But the fact that all those interactions sound so organic, and the way that you guys have described the world, I was going to buy it regardless because I have a Wii U, and apparently it's the best game since sliced bread, so...
I agonized for a long time over which one I preferred between this and Horizon, and I think I finally made the decision that I probably slightly prefer Horizon. But that's not a knock against Zelda at all. That's just because when I look at both of the games, I've probably got a couple of things that annoy the shit out of me about Zelda that could be easy fixes. But the highs are high, but the lows are a bit lower. But with Horizon, it's just consistent. So, yeah, I don't know. Horizon takes a lot less risks than Zelda does. But for that reason, I think it probably, delivers slightly better. But honestly, the difference is minuscule. Like, I love both of these games. They're both phenomenal. So, Jam, what are your thoughts? Does this attract you or...?
Yeah, no, I know this is a game I would love. It's just not enough to have me purchase a console for.
No, that's fair.
Because there's no other titles that really draw me. I played Twilight Princess. I enjoyed it. I can see, and just from what you've said, how much of an improvement this is on that formula. I might just have to borrow it.
Let's say if I only had friends, you could steal it off.
I'm crossing my fingers that I win the free one with the Paxos ticket sale. Mm. So... cross everything.
Yeah. This is one of those games like GTA where I may actually end up owning it on multiple platforms. We'll see.
Ooh.
Yeah. So, Christian, you were going to say?
Oh, I was just going to say quickly that I haven't played Horizon, but I intend to, and I wager that Zelda will come out on top for me, but that's only because of my attachment to the Zelda franchise. I've got that sort of history, and so I've sort of, a bit more of an emotional attachment to it, so it'll probably win out, but who knows? Horizon may surprise me and absolutely bowl me over.
We'll see. I mean, that's also considering that I haven't gotten quite as far into the game as you have yet, so my opinion may change. Disclaimer, opinion may change.
Sure, yeah.
Future, we'll see. We'll see how that goes, but yeah. So there you go. Legend of Zelda, Breath of the Wild, solid game. You should check it out. It's another one of those things that have happened this March that are pretty freaking good, and we should be thankful for. And we got Mass Effect just around the corner, so holy crap, that's another thing to look forward to. And Christian, I know you're a huge Mass Effect fan.
Oh god.
Go March.
Oh, it's gonna be good fun. So anyway, we'll wrap it up there. It's been a pretty solid episode, lots of stuff to think about for anyone who's been eyeing off the Legend of Zelda franchise and the latest entry. I think it's not disingenuous to say that a lot of the buzz for this game has been pretty accurate, but I would also go in eyes wide open. It is certainly not a perfect game. There are a few things that could be improved, but holy crap, they did a great job. So there you go.
They achieved what they wanted to achieve splendidly.
And it is a perfectly timed game to get people interested in the Switch, despite the lackluster launch library that is the case at the moment. So we will see.
Yeah.
We will see.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. Well, in the meantime, what are we looking forward to over the next week? We've still got, I think it's 8 days until Mass Effect. So what are people planning on doing in that amount of time? Christian, you sound like you're Horizon. Almost done with Zelda. Jam, you still got to finish Horizon.
I'm actually at the point where I have everything I need. I mean, you can fight him at the start of the game, but I'm ready to fight Ganon now. I might go and do it and actually finish the game probably tomorrow or the day after. And then after that, I'll probably pick up Horizon. The only other thing in the immediate week that I'm looking forward to is actually the Splatoon 2 beta test fire that's going to be on Switch. Is
awesome.
I quite enjoyed Splatoon on my Wii U, and so they're doing like the first multiplayer test fire in the coming week. So I'm going to check
this
that
out.
This
is the 1 hour window of opportunity several times a day, though, isn't it? The weird structured timing that they've got.
Yes.
Yeah.
Weird structured thing, yeah.
It'd be interesting to hear from you how that goes, actually, whether the actual time ends up being an hour or not, after all any particular connection issues and things are resolved. So super weird.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Ollie, if you do go and Zelda yourself, do you think you'll be doing that in the near future, or is that more of a back burner sort of thing for you?
Within the next couple of weeks, because it's not going to be bought for me, despite the fact that I'll be probably playing it a bit.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, I totally got this one.
I bought it for you, honestly, honey. Yep. I swear.
As well as this bowling ball with my name engraved on it.
Simpsons.
That's it. All right, cool. Well, yeah, let us know your thoughts if you are playing Breath of the Wild. It would be cool to get some feedback and other cool sort of emergent gameplay stories from people out there that are experimenting with some of the unique physics in there. So send those in to us via email if you like. We are mail@partyloaded.com. You can also hit us up on Facebook at facebook.com/partyloaded. We are on Twitter at partyloadedshow. When we're not playing Horizon Zero Dawn or Breath of the Wild, you can come and hang out with us on our Steam group where we play other games like Black Wake and all sorts of other fun. So you can do that. Just search for Party Loaded on Steam. We are also on iTunes. So if you've got any thoughts on our latest episode, please drop them in by way of a review. You can type your comments in there. And of course, we're putting content up on a semi-regular basis on YouTube. So you can check out our stuff at youtube.com/channelendgame. I've got some game footage of Breath of the Wild, which I'm looking forward to putting up in the next sort of week or so. I'm just going to carefully trim out some of the store spoilery stuff because I think there's some stuff in there that, I don't know. I could put spoiler warnings and stuff up, but I would kind of rather just trim it out and leave it as friendly as possible.
I'd put spoiler warnings up anyway. You're going to spoil it.
Look, people go,
it's what you do.
People go looking for game content on YouTube. I think you have to accept a certain amount of chance that that's going to happen. So,
yeah, that's fair.
Yeah, it's true. Fair. I mean, I've been deliberately staying away from it myself to avoid that, but it's never present risk. Like, don't get me wrong, there have been some moments where I've been very tempted to go and consult a guide because this game gets really difficult in parts, but I've resisted up to this point, so I'll continue to do so as long as I can. So there you go. So Christian, where can people find you if they actually want to get in touch? We should throw that out there. You want to drop your Twitch details when you hop back on and do some more of that?
Absolutely, yeah. So the main places you could find me are on Twitter at EGCPB. So you could follow me on there. And then on Twitch, I'm Millpool, so MILPOOL_HS. So MILPOOLHS on Twitch and at EGCPB on
nice.
Twitter.
Nice. And yeah, we would love to have you back on at some point. Maybe talk about some anime type games. Get your
maybe bring Personas out or something.
We could possibly do that. We'll have to. I don't know. There's got to be a game that we can all come to some common ground on. I'm sure there'll be something coming up in the future.
That's a fact.
Yeah, it's been awesome to be on the show, Luke. Thanks so much for the opportunity. And I'd love to come back someday.
You can talk Hearthstone with me anytime you want. All right. Anyway.
Yeah.
Let everybody go. All right.
Fly.
That's it. Yeah. All right. Well. Anyway, thanks for listening, everybody. We will see you back again next week for another layer of fun. Until then, good night.
Bye-bye.
Ta-ra.
Bye.
The Party Loaded podcast is a Channel Endgame production. For this and more great gaming content, bookmark channelendgame.com.